So first of all, thank the organizers for organizing such a great conference. In particular, so I'm going to talk about contact structures, foliations, and flows, and maybe some group actions too. So basically, this talk is going to maybe give a bit of background to some other talks that are going to happen this week, in particular by Thomas Vogel and Rachel Roberts. So there's going to be, and maybe even Andras's talk, there's going to be some connections there. So I want to set the setting and then go back right to the beginning and explain a bit about the geometry that we're interested in, and then explain the connection between contact topology and foliation theory given through the bridge of Eliasberg-Thurston's results on approximations of the two structures. And this is a bridge which is well traveled, but usually using foliation theory to go to contact topology, maybe to get some consequences in other places, but I want to go backwards. I'm going to use contact topology to say things about problems that are somehow naturally motivated from the contact side, but are set in the theory of foliations. So where does our story take place? Apart from the Institute in Princeton, is on a three manifold, M3, which for this talk will be closed and oriented. Okay, so both things are important. Maybe it's connected to that's not so such a big deal. And the major player is Mr. Squiggle. If you're Australian, you got that joke. Xi, which will be a two-plane field, and it will be globally co-oriented. So it's a kernel of a nowhere vanishing one form. And in the last talk, we already saw that there are foliations with certain extra conditions on regularity. Here we're going to assume that there is some regularity, just more for convenience. So say it's a smooth two-plane field in the manifold. So that's just every point, you know, you have a plane which wobbles around smoothly varying in the point. Okay, so let's see. Let's draw a little dictionary between foliations on the one hand and on the other side, contact structures and contact topology. So what they are, what they do, what they look like, what sort of properties they have. So of course I've written here foliations, and here I'm talking about two-plane fields. So this two-plane field is the tangent distribution to the foliation, which is the stack of bits of paper. So here, the condition I'm interested in is the integrability condition. So this plane field admits a foliation tangent to it. This is equivalent to this gadget. Okay? So this is by the Frobenius theorem. This condition on this one form says that I can find through every point a little disk which is tangent to my given distribution. Okay, so contact topology is sort of the negation of this, where this is not true. There exists no such little disk. So that says that this is never zero. And because I've got an orientation, I want to say I can have a notion of whether this is a positive. This is then a one form, that's two form. It's a three form and a three manifold with an orientation. I can associate a sign and my convention. So just in brackets, I'm talking really about positive contact structure. So this is never zero, and because of the orientation, I want to say non-integrability is this guy. And so throughout this entire talk, things over here are going to be equalities, and things over here are going to be inequalities. And they have, in a certain sense, very different properties a priori, but somehow there is a close relationship. So, okay, so that's the general condition. So what happens locally? This was a global sort of thing. So what happens locally? Let's have a look at this picture a bit more carefully. Ah, I shouldn't have done that. Apologies. So locally, what I want to do is pick a good coordinate system with respect to my plane field. So just some nice coordinates nearby. Good, where the z coordinate is going to be transverse to, say, this plane at one point and therefore nearby. It's an open condition. And I want these y guys to be Legendrian, i.e. tangent to my distribution. Remember, these things are not integrable, but you can always find a line, a bunch of lines that are tangent to it. Okay. So in such coordinates, the y component sort of is in the kernel of this thing. So therefore, my guy looks like locally looks like the kernel, sort of normalizing something like this. Well, my minus is just sort of a psychological convention, and the integrability condition here becomes that this function is constant in the y direction. Okay, you just throw it in there, you do a little baby calculation, you see this. So taking other coordinates, you can just take this to be constant, if you like, or to being zero by a change of coordinates. Okay, so then we have our standard local model that we know and love is a stack of bits of paper like this. Okay, so this is sort of the tangential condition, is when I flow along a foliation, I just, nothing happens. I just move in a sort of, without wobbling left or right. Well, what happens with this condition? Sort of the opposite. So the local model here is same using coordinates as above. You have this, where the condition is now, when you throw this into here, is that f is now a strictly monotone function in y, in the y direction. So if you like, fixing a y slice, I see a line field traced out on each y slice, a bunch of planes. And these planes, as people who've seen contact topology courts, they rotate in a fixed direction. So contact topology just does this. And whether I go to the left or to the right depends on whether I have a positive or a negative contact structure. So positive things go to the left and negative things go to the right. It's an unfortunate sort of historical fact. Okay, that should be not so surprising and fairly standard looking. Let me continue my dictionary here and look at something which is maybe more natural from the foliation side, which is to look at local holonomy of these gadgets. So if something is foliated, then, so I mean, look at a little cylinder piece and say these x, the z coordinate, x and y are the horizontal guys. And let's look on a tiny, teeny small scale, how do these things look? It looks like a stack of sheets. It might sort of wobble around, but if I look at what's traced out on the boundary of this little cylinder, what do I see? If these are all distant, I just see a bunch of circles. Okay, if it's sufficiently small, these things are sort of almost horizontal, so that makes sense. So what you see is that if you look at the holonomy, where I mean you take a transverse piece and you look at the first return map, I always come back on a local, on a small scale, to where I started. So what happens here? We can maybe guess. Something's got to change. It has to change in a particular way. So here we have the holonomy locally, and you can maybe globalize this in certain situations. As with this funny convention, you get that the local holonomy is negative. Meaning what? So I should draw the picture. So remember what a contact structure is. That is when I go along the Legendrian line field, I have to turn to the left. So imagine I place myself in this central pole here, and then start there and start moving out. What happens? I tip whichever radial direction I go in to the left. So when I go to the boundary, I have negative slope. On the boundary, I have negative slope. So what happens when I look at my first return map here? So I start here and I'm going with negative slope, and I return here. Here, and then h of x, the holonomy around this little thing here, so on a small scale.
Is the curve
just a Legendrian curve in the boundary? Yes, okay. Because it's transverse, exactly. It's a Legendrian line field. Okay, so that's the geometry here. You have here sort of constant in one direction, here you have strict monotonicity. And there's something in between, which is how the Eliasberg-Thurston theory goes, between foliations and contact structures. What's in between is called a confoliation, and that's where you just take sort of not strict inequalities, but just ordinary inequalities. And there's something interesting happening here, because this inequality here, although the definition needed some derivatives of alpha, this does not. Okay, this thing, if I take a small c0 change in the plane field, so if the angles just change a bit on a fixed scale, so on this one piece, this condition doesn't change. And that's actually an important thing that Thomas used and other people to get some sort of c0 like stability in this setting where it's perhaps not immediately obvious. Okay, so it was kind of mentioned already in the previous talk, but I want to elaborate a little bit, that both of these things exist in abundance. Why, how, who did that? I just want to say some names and give the idea of why that's true. So let's see. We'll do that here. So because many of these results happened before anyone in this room was born, I don't know what the percentage is, but I think it's rather high. I'll say it's prehistory. I don't want to be rude, so in brackets. So some prehistoric results. What Nathan already mentioned is that, so on the foliation side, so just the raw existence, I think, goes back to licorice, but the way I'm going to state it, I think it's pseudo-wood, and the sort of construction that I want to describe briefly is Sturston, so it's really sort of wood, and maybe there's a licorice here, but that gives you existence. And on the foliation side, Lutz Martinet, I don't really know what happened there, because my French isn't very good, but ask him and he'll tell you precisely all the gory details. Yeah, yeah. So. Okay, so we can't read minds, and it happened before you were born, I guess. Good. So they say that if you take any old stupid plane field satisfying no a priori condition, then as a plane field you can homotope it to one which is a tangent to a foliation, so an integrable one, let's shoot these guys, and then a contact structure on the other hand, whether positive or negative doesn't matter. So I'll draw a cartoon sketch of what's going on here. So cartoon in the sense you shouldn't take it too seriously, but it sort of, you know, gets at the heart of the matter, I think. So this is essentially somehow a local issue, constructing things. So take our three manifold, break it into teeny, teeny, teeny pieces where our plane field on each piece doesn't do a whole lot, and then make this trans field by, make this triangulation by a jiggling in general position, meaning that what you see on faces when you've got a two-plane field is a bunch of aligned fields, so a bunch of lines running around. Okay, so what could be a problem is something like this. If I want to build a foliation and I have some picture like this on the boundary and I want to sort of start with just a line field which restricted to the face, sorry, start with a plane field which restricted to the faces is just a bunch of lines, which is integrable, and then I sort of see something like this, this is going to be bad in the sense that if I extend this a little bit near the two skeleton then try to extend it over the three skeleton, that's impossible by Rabe stability. So that's a problem. And on the other hand, if for a contact structure, the holonomy doesn't go down all the time, but somehow sometimes goes up and sometimes goes down for the same reason, because of this condition, I can't just easily fill it in, okay? So, but what is easy? So step one is you just do it, make a foliated or contact near the two skeleton. Okay, you have to be a little bit careful, you know, you have to do it inductively, doing it near vertices, I can even do that. Then maybe the edges is also pretty easy. In faces, you see line fields, and then you have to twist for the non-integrable guys, and otherwise you just flow and make an invariant under a little flow transverse here, near the two skeleton, and then sort of key thing, then you get a bunch of holes left, and then you fill the holes. All right. Just fill them, but it's not quite that simple because, as I said, that's not easy to do. So what this leads to, on the foliated side and on the contact structure side, is these sorts of things. So what is this? It's my attempt at a refoliation. So what is that if you've not so familiar with foliation theory? It's a foliation on a solid torus, so that the boundary is itself a leaf. Okay, it's this thing. So this thing is a leaf, and then inside you have parabolic cups. So if you imagine, the easiest way to imagine is, it's cut this open and go to the universal cover of this picture. And then all you have is a bunch of sort of rocket ship cups stacked upon one another, and you make a translation invariant so you can descend to the quotient. What that looks like here is a finger wrapping inside itself, or a worm is maybe appropriate. They're sort of dirty creatures, so they sort of wind around and eat themselves up. And they sort of infinitely eat themselves up, and then you sort of have this picture that this thing here is a circle that bounds a disk on this parabolic cup, and as you move out to the boundary, this disk becomes longer and bigger and bigger and bigger and sort of explodes as you go to the boundary. So you use this guy not to fill in this hole, but you make this hole a bit bigger by finding a curve here which is sort of transverse to the thing you've built, say near the one skeleton, and then opening up a bit, and you fill in this guy by being sort of using some tricks. And then on the foliated side, there's something called something called overtwisted disk, which is the analog, if you like, of the rope component. So rather than maybe giving a formal definition, what is that? It's a disk. What have I drawn here? You've got this two-plane field. I've drawn the characteristic foliation induced from this two-plane field on this disk. So this is an elliptic tangency. It's a tangency. And you're twisting out as you move out. And what I'm saying is, when you get to the boundary, you've done a full half twist. Okay. So how does this picture relate to this one? Well, if you imagine these things, these cups, if you take a transverse disk and you look how the cups intersect, it looks like a bullseye. And in the middle, you have this one elliptic tangency. Okay, so to move from this to this, you look at this disk here. And this is how you fill the holes on this side, and that's how you fill them there. Okay, so if you allow these sorts of things, this is very well known, and this is a bit later. If you allow these sorts of things, you have an enormous amount of flexibility. So if you like, this is the up here with the existence. H principle, this was it. And then you've sort of got the uniqueness question. So this stuff, that means they exist. And these things are not geometrically interesting, but how sort of unique are they, up to some sort of notion of equivalence, which I'll get to in a second. So so historically, that came first, and then the sort of the uniqueness thing, the contact side came first, so the Ashberg's classification of over-twisted contact structures from 89 or something. This is 60s, 70s. So what does this say? Uniqueness in the following sense. So if I take two contact structures, C0 and C1, which are over-twisted in the sense of, you can find a disk like this. You can find a disk whose boundary is tangent, and you have an elliptic tangency in the middle. You've done a full half twist. So we'll call such a thing an over-twisted contact structure. So I want to know when these are equivalent. If they're isotopic, then in particular they'd be homotopic, just as plane fields. And if you have this, the theorem is that you can integrate this, if you like, to a deformation through such things. So there exists a contact deformation. T is just in the interval, contact deformation. Okay. And for those who know some contact topology, this, the existence of this by gray stability, so after the fact, implies that this deformation through contact structures can be realized by an isotopy. So in particular, these things are actually equivalent in a much stronger sense. But something like this definitely can't be true in foliation theory, because there's a lot of stupid things you can do. You can sort of grow these rape components and have lots of different sort of, the number of closed leaves, for example, can change dramatically. So this can never be true in the foliated sense, but this deformation uniqueness, if you like, which is in a sense a sort of, this is a question about sort of surjectivity on pi zero certain structures, and this is like injectivity. So that's the contact side, and then we've got some LN-Einar. And putting a number on this is difficult. I don't know, 09. In the interval of 09 to 15, sometime in between, it sort of became, got written down or got published, something like that. And you start with the same sort of thing. So you start with any integrable plane fields that are just homotopic as plane fields. Now here we needed an assumption. It couldn't just be anything random. There are contact structures that are in the same homotopy class which are not isotopic. So you need plus something. Maybe I won't say that yet. Then the conclusion, so what is this something? Then the conclusion is the same, that there exists a deformation through integrable things from the one to the other. Okay, so you need an assumption, and one assumption which is sort of nice, which is sort of orthogonal to the thing at the top, is that it's taut. Okay, so remember, rape components were sort of the analog of a twisted. Taut means there's no rape components, so that's sort of orthogonal, but what it does is it allows you to grow rape components by taking lots of transversals. And another one is that it's generic. So generic in the sense that if you take one foliation, then you can approximate it by one for which this will become true. So it's almost true. For most things, it's true. For a general guy, it's true.
Sorry, you say both conditions
should be satisfied,
or either?
It's either or. So plus this or this. Yeah. Yeah, I don't want to say it. But it's true for generic foliation. It's something about the holonomy near toral leaves, if you really want to know. So it's a genericity assumption, which is generic. So for most things, it's true. All right, it's better to maybe leave that to her. So is it clear what I mean? I mean, if you take a random one, then you can find one which is very close to it where this is true. So this is an open condition, of course, tautness. Genericity.
Sorry, I didn't hear what you said. You just said tautness is not preserved.
Tautness is an open condition, if you...
Well, is taut
generic, is that what you're saying?
No, I'm asking whether, if you assume that these are taut, so
yes.
The theorem is true.
Yes.
Is it true that the approximating family...
No. So that's exactly what I was going to say now. Thank you. So, thank you. I didn't plant this member in the audience, but I'll give you your money later. So the point is exactly what I just said. So when you have a taut foliation that's got a lot of transversals, you can grow rib components. So the way this proof goes, the first thing you do is you destroy this wonderful taut foliation by growing a whole bunch of rib components. So this deformation, so the remark is, this needs rib components. Not only needs, but uses them. In C1, yeah. But I said everything's smooth. So, yeah, you're right. That would be if this is C1 deformation.
Yeah, but also, I think in some sort of topology, you have got something which is connected, but maybe not path.
Yeah, okay. But,
okay. But you want a path, right?
Yeah, I want a path. All right. So that was sort of by way of motivation, in a sense. So this thing uses rape components, and the sort of question, one of the main questions in this talk is, are they necessary? This is one of the, and there's no way you would even think about asking this question without this contact thing in between, right? So that, what is that? Maybe everything I wanted to say about prehistory. Yeah, let's move on to, ooh, I got rumor chalk, awesome. Can I keep this? And sell it on eBay or something. So what's the thing between them, which is sort of alluded to already, is the approximation result of Thurston and the Ashberg. So let's take a foliation, and here it's the classical version. So it's a C2 foliation, and there's a big knot, which is S2 cross S1 with this rape stability thing I already mentioned. This foliation just isn't going to work. So see that directly. So take any old foliation, then you get there exists a pair, so positive and negative, and the and is important. Contact structures nearby. Arbitrarily, C0 close to F, in the sense the tangent distributions are close. So what I mean you have another thing where the angle between the two planes is arbitrarily small. Okay. So this is important. So I'm going to say something about that in a second. But so the first remark is what are these contact structures good for? So Thomas Vogel proved that in sort of under what you might call the obvious necessary assumptions, these guys, C plus minus, are unique up to isotopy. Meaning, I'll draw a moral picture of what's going on here. And see his talk. So this is sort of what we're after. He already gives us somehow what we're after. So under the obvious necessary assumptions, you have a foliation that gives you a contact structure of isotopy, and contact topology has been developing for a long, long time, sort of distinguishing such things. So the obvious, one of the obvious things is that it's taut. So that's one of the, these things are all taut. Okay, so it's taut plus you have to exclude some sort of special cases. So, and then number two, which Nathan already mentioned, is that I sort of, and Will and Rachel Roberts have shown that this C2 is not so necessary. So it's true for C0 foliations. So I was, of course, a bit quick. This C2 is, in the sense of foliation theory, so holonomy maps a C2. A stronger condition will be that the plane field is C2, I assume it's smooth. And here I just assume you have some foliation tangent to something. You need something to approximate. So it can't be some random foliation by just topological surfaces. You need a plane field. So it's, and it varies continuously in the transverse direction, if you like, in the sort of tangential direction, everything's nice. So this you can get rid of. There is, of course, the other chance to sort of change things, and that's here. And that's, I think, pretty open question and kind of hard. So can you approximate, say, CK foliation in a CK sense by contact structures? Sort of has to do with subtle questions about like foliations without holonomy. Okay, so where does this thing get going? It gets going when you add a bit more to our thing here. So contact sign. So we already had, so if we have a taut foliation, and you take these guys, these approximating guys, so Ashberg doesn't already show that you get something weakly fillable, whatever that means. But in particular, these things are not overtwisted. This condition to tautness means that these guys cannot have these things. You sort of expect that from this picture. If you had a rev component, you're sort of seeing this overtwisted disk somehow in the transverse section. Okay? But you get something a bit stronger. It's got some, it's weakly fillable. What's the reason for that? You have a sort of calibration on the foliation, which is of a closed two form, which is positive on it, and that gives you some sort of natural symplectic filling. Okay, so the condition of having a transversal, you can soup that up by nearby the transversal. You just have a sort of local product structure for the foliation. Take an area form on the disk, go around, and you see nearby a sort of little form which is positive nearby to that transversal. By compactness, you take a bunch of them, you get something positive everywhere. Okay, so that's good. So this is taut. Transversals everywhere. But then you can sort of, so taut is a particular Reibless. And this corresponds to just not having, so this, i.e., tight means no overtwisted disk. OK, so that is, again, basically, so this is Eliashben Dustin's a long time ago. And then there was sort of a bogus proof in the book. And some people along the way fix it up, and I sort of sorted that out in the smooth case. So all these sorts of things, say these questions and these questions. So what I wrote here is under the assumption of C2. So everything I say in this talk, somehow due to this thing here, you can sort of ask what's still true under this weaker assumption. And this result, for example, it's far from clear whether that should remain true. But it's interesting. Okay, so so taut implies variableless. So this implies this. This implies this. Why? Because if I was taut, I have a transverse curve through this separating torus, which I got. Okay, so. Very good. This is a segue into Andy's talk. Where is he? There you go. Yes. I think we'll hear about that in your talk this afternoon, right? Yeah. So, yes. Very good. No. 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 It's different. So I'm lying a little bit. So there's a relation. So if you have a variableless foliation, you sort of have a JSJ decomposition into sort of tight pieces with toral boundary. So there is a relationship, but it's not just a direct implication. Anything else? Further lack of clarity. So what do I want to do? I want to talk about a problem. So the problem, sort of motivated by this result, and seeing what happened over there is, problem one, which is maybe a big thing, is to study the space of taut foliations on a given manifold. So sort of in this sense, so not necessarily do you have one, that's already a hard, interesting thing, as we saw in the first talk. So, you know, is this thing non-empty? It's sort of a bunch of constructive results, but in general you got no idea. But this is sort of in the sense of, well, what about the topology? So how many components do you have? Do you have plenty? Do you have very few? Are the higher homotopy groups, stuff like that? So what's sort of this thing as a topological space? So how do you get a topology? You know, you have this defining one from alpha, so that naturally sits in a section space with a topology, that's what I mean. And sort of the thing that I want to get to today is where this sort of stuff doesn't appear, you take a specific class of, so study this thing, and a sort of sub-problem is to study a space of foliations with sort of a global transverse structure. So space of foliations, taut sort of not written here, that are horizontal where you have a global transverse structure. So the manifold itself fibers over a surface. So it's an S1 bundle. And of course you can sort of vary it by saying it's a ciphered fibered space. You know, all the questions I said today, you can sort of vary like that. So it's not too study, but it's to study. So, right. I'm into cartoons, obviously. So what's the idea motivated by what I've said over there is, so it's a dodgy idea, but sometimes dodgy ideas become good when you add some assumptions. And so the very sketchy idea is we're interested in knowing, are there a bunch of taut foliations here that are not somehow connected to each other in this space? So they are connected to each other in the space of all foliations by Ellen and R's result, but in this restricted class here or here. So that's sort of going to mirror this thing here. So you'd expect the answer to be no, and that's what it's going to be. But I want to draw a very sketchy thing. So imagine we had two foliations, F0 and F1. Well, I really mean the tangent distributions of these guys. And imagine there was such a deformation between them. Well, take my wonderful chalk here, and imagine you could then take this whole deformation and make it into a deformation of contact structures. Deformation of contact structures is an isotopy, corresponds to an isotopy. So you have contact invariants. So the dodgy idea is to approximate deformations of foliations. So deformations. Deformations of contact structures. So So this is what I meant. Usually you go from foliation theory to say something about the existence of these things, and now I want to sort of get non-existence of paths out of contact topology. So that's, I'm inverting the bridge. Because it's wrong. So you can take a deformation. So Thomas will say this, so I'm sorry if I take this out of your mouth, but you can just take foliations on the three torus where you're changing the slope, and that sort of slope is seen in the contact world. So that thing I sort of mentioned is one of the things you exclude here, but that's the sort of, the dodginess is, you need to, this won't work in full generality and it cannot. Okay, so, and as I said, I don't want to concentrate, I want to concentrate on this sort of subproblem because it's sort of nice. It has to do with other things. So I want to talk about some results about this space, but seen through the eyes of holonomy rather than in this geometric setting upstairs. I want to look at it through this more natural setting in foliation theory through holonomy. So, applications. To group actions on S1. Okay. So I said, so let's just make an observation. So the space of foliations, which are horizontal to a global circle bundle, given a circle downstairs, you see what happens when you push along the foliation upstairs, and that gives you a holonomy map. Okay. And because it's a flat structure, this gives you, by my assumptions, the plus means orientation preserving, that's co-orientability, and diff means it's a smooth map. You can take the data to homeo, then you would have sort of C0 world. So, let's see. So I want to give a very down, sort of simple-minded tool to get away to make this dodgy idea mildly less dodgy. So this is so-called linear deformations of foliations. So we want to make an assumption on the foliation. So I already sort of alluded to this. Toral leaves are bad, and let's just throw away all closed leaves. So assume F has no compact leaves. That's a strong assumption, but this dodgy idea, which is going to turn via this lemma with an extra assumption into an actual proof of something, and mildly interesting, or depending how you see it. So F has no closed leaves, and this is a general case now. So this sort of lemma is not just applying to this thing, but it applies more generally. M does not fiber over S1, so not fibered. Then you can sort of do this in the following sort of strong sense. Then there exists a one form, beta, so that linearly, you do what you want. Now, observe if this is alpha defining my F. Maybe it disappeared. So alpha is the defining form for my tangent distribution. There, that's the alpha. And then I'm saying, you just imagine try to take alpha and do the most stupid thing and take a linear deformation. Take alpha plus T beta. And you hope that becomes the contact structure very soon. So you just write down the contact condition. And then this is the linear part of that. The zero order term is vanishing because it's by the integrability condition, right? The zeroth order term is not there. That's the linear term. And this condition, so this is a lemma of Thurston already in their book, allows you to do this. So that's very good, because then you can just take alpha plus, say, epsilon times beta, and this will be define a contact structure as its kernel. Okay, so you can put a plus minus, is going to be positive negative contact. Okay. Well, I already said it's hard to do this in general, but we've just done it. Why? Because I just take my magical haguruma, which is kaedogara, and I imagine I've got a smooth perturbation now. Okay, so now imagine I have a smooth family of foliations. Okay, so then I have a defining form for each t. This lemma says I can find a bt. And then what happens here? This condition is convex in beta. So alpha is sort of fixed. That's the defining form. And now I'm trying to perturb. So I just take, for each t, I take one of these things. And then I can just take a partition of unity to sort of glue them together. Okay. So a line of things satisfying this condition, the whole line satisfies this condition. All right. So that means I can do exactly this under this assumption. But what I want to say is that this assumption is satisfied, in particular in the setting of problem two, under not so restrictive assumption. So then using this tool, we can prove a little theorem. So let's see. So the space of representations, which naturally inherits a topology, take standard generators here and consider that as a sort of a subset of the product satisfying the surface relation, standard way. So this space rep one G. Okay. Well, this thing already has a bunch of components, which you sort of know very well. If you even restrict to the much smaller subgroup PSL2R, you know you've got by Milner-Wood bounds anything between 2 minus 2g and 2g minus 2. So this has a bunch of, this is sort of partitioned naturally by the Euler class. So I want to fix the Euler class, otherwise this is obviously not connected or path connected. So the space is not connected, path connected, I'll say, I'll be careful. More is true, I'll say in a second, connected. For what? For E, random absolute values, well, equals 2g minus 2 over k less than 2g minus 2. So I just mean this thing divides this and it's not equal to it. And I want to say a word about this. If I had this, then G's already told me that this thing is connected. It's very strong rigidity here in this case. Any thing in the component, the sort of Teichmuller component here, is smoothly conjugate to a Fuchsian representation. And the space of Fuchsian representations, Teichmuller space, is connected. You know, hell of a lot more. But, and this, in the case where you have zero Euler class, is a big, fat, unknown, wide, wide world. Maybe it's not. So in particular, this includes the case of the G0, so you have fundamental group of torus, so you have commuting diffeomorphisms. That's about connectedness of the space of commuting diffeomorphisms with some regularity. Depending what R is, if it's not 1 or 0, it's a hard, deep question in dynamics. Okay, but in this case, in between, you can just cook up natural, fairly natural things. So I just committed a sin, this just broke, I'm sorry. Please don't cry. So what do I need to do? I need to tell you some examples, all right? And then we've got a tool that's going to do our work for us. So an example of two representations here that are sort of coming naturally to us. So already something's acting on the circle. Let's take the circle as the boundary of hyperbolic plane. Then, of course, PSL2R acts very nicely via obvious transformations and sort of a generic element, a hyperbolic element has this sort of dynamics, fixed points and something like this. These are fixed points, attracting one repelling. Okay, and I just take let's take rho zero to be, there's my pi one sigma g. Well, I'm not sort of maximal, so to get something coming from some nice Fuchsian thing, I'm going to have to take my genus, get rid of a bit by collapsing, and then take over here. This is just given by, so some compact lattice inside here. So I'm taking the composition of a map which is highly non-injective with an inclusion. So this thing, this composition, that's what I'm interested in. So this is a collapse. This is a co-compact lattice isomorphic to pi 1 sigma g bar, which is something of smaller genus, so that this equation I get agrees with the Euler characteristic of this thing. So 2 g bar minus 2 should be equal to this. Okay, so, and then, so this is a sort of flexible thing, because I've added flexibility because I've taken my rigid thing and sort of made it non-rigid, stupidly. So how to get something rigid in the same class? Well, you sort of use this very great idea that a circle wraps around itself, and well-known fact. So let's wrap a circle around itself and take things in here and lift them, and you get something with a very different looking dynamics. So let's take row one to be a lift of a Fuchsian guy to the k-fold cover, not the universal cover like last time, but just something in between. So that's where the k is coming from. So this is the k-fold cover where I lift things by wrapping k times around the circle. So this would be the case of lifting this guy here, my fixed points have multiplied by 2. So I've drawn here the case k equals 2. Okay. So these are going to be the two representations. You can sort of guess, you know, this looks incredibly rigid, right? You've taken something which is a lattice in a Lie group. This thing is still a lattice in a Lie group. And this guy has not been. So this is somehow rigid. Exactly, it's under this condition, yeah. So I'm sort of sweeping under the rug. Okay, so then let's crank up our machine and just quickly sketch the proof. Exactly, it's going to be necessary for the proof. I hope not, but I don't know. Look at Katie and see what she does. She nods. Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
We
so.
Put money on both sides. Don't
yeah. I don't want to stick my neck out here, but so maybe I'll give the proof and then say some remarks later. So. A quick sketch of the proof is step one. So assume that there is, between these two representations, a sort of smooth deformation. So assume there exists such a deformation from row 0 to row 1. Okay, well, this one side of the arrow, this is given by holonomy, and the other direction is given by suspending this representation. So you just take a product of the universal cover with S1, and you act on the circle by the representation on the one factor. The other one you act by deck transformations, and the quotient you get a foliation, which is called the suspension. So then you suspend to get a smooth family of foliations. Okay. And then two, you perturb. This thing into a smooth family using our dodgy idea, so contact deformation. Okay, why can we use the dodgy idea? Because we've got a global transverse structure, and we're assuming the Euler class is non-zero. This is exactly saying there are no closed leaves, because you've had a closed leaf. Okay, you get a closed leaf which intersects every phi versus ak times, but that's as good as having a as good as going to a lift, pulling back to a cover, that's as good as having a section, which means the Euler class is torsion, and because it's a surface, that means it's zero. Okay, so that is satisfied, and by thinking about it a little bit, these sorts of ciphered fiber things cannot fiber over surfaces, at least if the genus is not one, but that's hiding in this assumption here. The genus, so maybe I should make it explicit, just because it's a little bit hidden, the genus here is at least two. So this is even has a chance of being satisfied. So hyperbolic surface. So then three is to use some contact topology plus a bit of care. So what do I mean by care? Well, we've got some contact deformation, but if you want to identify the contact structures you get, you should choose these guys at the end carefully. So that's what I mean by care. You just choose those. And because these things are sort of coming from homogeneous examples, which are quotients of Lie groups, you can pick up this deformation by just looking at the Lie algebra and sort of looking at how things deform in the Lie algebra. So inside the Lie algebra here, you have a sort of, if you like, have this, it's PSL2R, so it's the universal it's the unit tangent bundle of H2, and that thing has sort of nice Arnoldsov flow. Okay, so you have an Arnoldsov flow with a stable direction and an unstable direction, and you tip those a bit. If this guy was unstable, then this cross, if that's the stable direction, let's see if I can get this right. So I drew a picture, so I should check. So say this thing is stable, so this direction contracting and that thing's expanding, right? So then if you tip this a bit, so I should tip it like that, then as you flow along, you're twisting because this thing's being pushed down and this thing's being pulled that way. So you're seeing this contact deformation sort of before your eyes coming from the Arnoldsov here. The Arnoldsov flow on, if you like, the unit cotangent bundle of H2 or some covering of that under a fiberwise pullback. Okay, so that's another sort of instance of the rigidity. So take care, and then so use contact topology, but it's not HF hat, it's not contact homology, it's very sort of low tech stuff. So, and what you do is you take something called enroulement, or twisting, as an invariant of these things, maybe goes back to Giroux. So what Giroux did is he classified all contact structures on these sorts of manifolds. And the sort of main invariant is this thing, and it's a numerical invariant. And from this guy on the left, the dynamics. So I'm just saying, let's see. So contracting and expanding, take this line, and my, I don't know, it's flowing out this way. So this thing twists.
That line,
exactly, that twist.
Okay,
so this goes like this, and this goes like this. So like an X-wing fighter twisting. All right, so this invariant, I just wanted to say, is a really sort of simple-minded thing. But it's good enough to do what we want. And the point is this K here corresponds to something called the enroulement. What is that? I'll just say it. If you're not familiar with contact topology, it mightn't make so much sense. But on these manifolds, you have a fiber, okay? So you try and make this fiber tangent to your plane field. It's called a Legendrian knot. And then when you have a Legendrian knot, you get a canonical framing because you've got this two-plane field and you've picked one direction already, and then you've got something left over because you have orientation. Okay, and then you see how often that twists relative to the framing coming from the projection downstairs. So you have a sort of zero framing naturally, even though it's a null homologous thing in general. And then you see the minimum number, and under such coverings, this thing acts multiplicatively, not in general, but under this, in this rigid situation, this thing's multiplicative. And here, I just wanted to say, the dynamics of this thing were very simple. You had one fixed point attracting, one repelling. So in the suspension, the sort of, if you like, when you suspend that thing, you see a pair of, so this is on the torus now, so when you suspend such a thing, you're seeing something with an attractive fixed point, something repelling. And then this picture, so this is supposed to be corresponding to the fixed point at the top, this is corresponding to the fixed point at the bottom, picture on T2. You're seeing, when you look at the suspension, exactly two closed orbits, two periodic orbits, one attracting, one repelling. And this picture is stable, say, because we're perturbing in C infinity sense, this is stable. Okay, so this picture doesn't change, and that's something you can read off. That allows you to read off the invariant on the left-hand side. The right-hand side, you need to use some sort of rigidity of classification, okay? But it's not using Floer theory, it's not using stuff like that. Thanks, Ian. So if any made a comment about this, I can't remember what it was. There should be a sign for I can't remember. Okay, so that's pretty much all I wanted to say on that thing. And I just want to say a few words in the last couple of minutes on somehow some problems that naturally occur about thinking like this related to studying this thing. don't get ahead of myself. So one remark is, again, what's true in C0? So I put a paper in the archive and got an email a couple of months later. This is true for homeo. So Katie proved that the same result there is true for homeo. But with the same examples, right? The same. Yeah. So there's no more or less as far as we know, but it's true. And you can take out the path in the connected. Okay, so the other one was that somehow it's some rigidity of Anosov. So let's maybe come up one. There's some rigidity of Anosov, some global rigidity or something of Anosov in this setting for the edges. So I mean, like, these things are on the rigid side are the stable foliation of some Anosov flow. So just really quickly. So let's take this thing, and as Nathan remarks, if you take the universal cover, this thing acts on the line by one periodic diffeomorphism. So you can identify that thing. Let's just take this, and let's compute this Euler class. So take standard generators here and lift them. Any old how? Write down the product of commutators, and what gets spat out is some topological quantity, which is the Euler number. So rep E, if you like. You can sort of soup that up to say, rather than just taking elements here, you sort of lift them, and then you have a condition on these things that product of commutators is a topological quantity. So let's consider the space of all elements in here, so two G tuples corresponding to standard generators, so that this is equal to this. And that's a slight variant of the thing without the tuple is a bit of sort of twisting information there. And this argument we showed above somehow says you can take any such representation and get some sort of contact representation to diff. So just by being able to perturb to something, you can still take holonomies because you've still got a plane field. So you still have holonomies. But this condition, this foliator condition, gets turned into this condition. Because you have a global transversal, so this condition just becomes a global inequality. So this thing becomes an inequality. E is the number. And moreover, you don't have to make it all that non-integrable because we had a sort of way of deforming this epsilon here. It can be as small as you like. So you can write an epsilon here. Okay? And that just means that this thing is somehow like this. So what is this? So that's what I just want to say, sort of raise a question at the end rather than answering anything. So sort of question. In particular, so you've got these sort of restricted things, which sort of appear naturally here. This thing. And then you can just forget about the epsilon, and there you've sort of just got contact structures on the corresponding M over S1, which are horizontal. So what I mean is that it's not a representation, it's what I mean here. So it satisfies this funny condition.
So why not just have a representation of the
function? That's a very good thing to say, yeah. So, but yeah. So I won't write it down, but what Danny said is a good thing to do. I just meant the set of things satisfying this sort of inequality. So the non-integrability is somehow, it's controlled non-integrability. So the point is, this is sort of the situation when epsilon, if you like, goes to infinity. So this thing is understood, basically, by Giroux. So this is understood, sort of. I think you can understand it pretty easily. But what happens in between? So if something happens, then you're going to get information about this space. So that's my motivation. I want to understand this. So what is this? So is this an equivalence? Is there some value of epsilon where things change? Is there sort of different epsilons? Is there some, I don't know, quantity dependent epsilon? Okay, so thank you for your attention.